Welcome to the 700 Club. Tragedy has struck the Philippines as that island nation is struggling after a major typhoon. Nearly 250 people are dead from flooding alone.
And that government says it needs help before things get worse. Here's reporter John Jessup.
The devastation can be seen everywhere you turn. Bloated rivers, dirty, muddy streets, and about a half million flooded homes. It's the result of a tropical storm that dumped more than a month's worth of rain in just 12 hours over the weekend and led to the worst flooding the country has seen in 42 years.
We were so scared of the flood. All we can do was really pray.
The storm has killed more than 240 people, but the death toll is expected to climb. Rescuers are still pulling bodies out of the rubble and crested waters, and many are still missing. This man says he lost track of his wife when their roof collapsed. They had climbed on top to escape the rising floodwaters. American missionaries Jerome and Heather Sack moved to the Philippines earlier this year with their two children. Jerome chronicled their ordeal on the social networking website Facebook with photos and video, ominously reporting what they saw. Typhoon in the Philippines. Water rising to our door fast, moving things upstairs.
Right here is our front steps, and you'll see that it's covering a couple of steps, and then once you get out to the street, it goes down to the street, so it's getting closer and closer.
The sacks are okay, but the suffering in the Philippines is far from over. The flooding forced nearly 2 million people from their homes. CBN's Operation Blessing dispatched doctors going house to house in devastated neighborhoods. They helped this woman and her sick baby. They were trapped on the roof for hours.
My baby has fever because he got soaked in the rain when we climbed to the roof to save ourselves from the rising water.
And as if things couldn't get any worse, more bad news may be on the horizon. Forecasters are tracking two separate storms in the Pacific, one that could hit the Philippines later this week and another early next. John Jessup, CBN News.
Breaks your heart. Those people are right at the edge of poverty. They say that's our, the Philippine answer to Katrina. We had a horrible storm in the New Orleans area. Operation Blessing mobilized in New Orleans, and we're doing the same thing in the Philippines. Here's what's happening. Our teams are mobilizing to provide food, clean water, and emergency medical care. Operation Blessing disaster relief teams are getting food and clean water distributions, deploying medical teams in hardest hit areas. And already teams are partnering with local churches to help fund more than 4,000 or 5,000 affected residents. We'll be doing much more, but it's a huge tragedy. And the aid that has been offered isn't coming in fast enough. They need everything, every bit of help we can give them. So pray for the Philippines, dear, wonderful people, and it breaks your heart to see them suffering in this way. Lee Webb has the rest of our top stories from the CBN newsroom. Lee.
Pat, public support for the Democrats' health care plan has hit a new low in the polls. A new Rasmussen survey shows only 41% of voters nationwide support the plan and 56% are opposed. The poll also finds that senior citizens are much less supportive of the plan than younger voters. Meanwhile, pro-life legislators from both parties want to make sure that a federal plan would not include funding for abortion. And liberal Democrats in the Senate are facing off against their more moderate colleagues over whether the government should offer the so-called public option. That's a government-run insurance plan for the middle class that would compete with private companies. Pat?
Well, Lee, I just think they ought to scrap that thing and start all over again. It is flawed. The American people don't want it. And it's time that Congress, that has a ten ears, start listening to what the people are saying. The people don't like it. They don't like it. And Obama thinks it's a feather in his cap to enhance his prestige. But we don't want to saddle America with some horrible health care system just in order to make the president feel good. The time has come to say, let's scrap what's there, go back to the drawing board, and carefully consider the things that are necessary and leave out all the stuff that's not necessary. Lee?
Pastors in about 80 churches across the U.S. preached partisan political sermons this past Sunday. They're part of something called the Pulpit Initiative, sponsored by the Alliance Defense Fund. The program is designed to challenge the IRS to revoke the church's tax-exempt status. The ADF says the effort hopes to restore, quote, a pastor's right to speak freely from his pulpit without fearing censorship or punishment by the government. But the organization says the program is not about encouraging pastors to endorse candidates, only to speak out on cultural issues from a biblical perspective. The president of the World Bank is warning that the dollar may not always be the main currency for international trade. Robert Zoellick says the dollar will remain a major currency, but he says the euro and China's currency could become more popular in the international markets. He warns the dollar's outlook will depend heavily on U.S. decisions on key issues like reducing the debt and cutting the huge federal deficit. Pat?
Well, when you are profligate, you bear the consequences. You remember the story of the son who went away and wasted his substance on riotous living. We are wasting our substance. Congress is out of control. It's been out of control for years. Administrations have been out of control. It's amazing. They don't seem to regard the dollar as anything important. And if we lose our reserve currency status, it will mean that we have to borrow money every time we need to buy something. As it is now, all we do is just issue dollars because it's the reserve currency. And people say, okay, it's a dollar, we take it. But the time will come when they say, no, we're not going to take it any longer because it's not worth as much as you think it is. So we're going to be looking at a haircut on our currency, 30-40%, and it can mean that prices of everything is going to go up, or prices will go up, and it's going to cause a great deal of pain in this country.
Well, this is a little heads up that it's not that far off.
Well, it's the price of profligacy. We have been profligate. We are like the son who wasted his money in riotous living. We have spent money on the craziest things. It makes no sense. There's been no plan. We just wasted. We said, well, after all we got to do is tax and get the money. Or we could issue some more bonds. Well, there comes a time that the foreigners say, we're not going to take your bonds anymore. It's going to happen, ladies and gentlemen, and when it does, it's going to cost a lot. In the meantime, protect your assets. Do not keep your money tied up in dollars, because the dollar is a sinking currency.
Well, up next, it's the birthplace of the cell phone, the Intel chip, and countless other technological breakthroughs. See why one of the most advanced nations in the world is also one of the most hated after this.
So you finally decided that it's the right time for you to lose weight. That's great. And maybe you're considering going to Weight Watchers.
Weight Watchers!
Oh, no, girl. Oh,
you're going to try something new.
I am.
We're clear. Go, 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 go!
Introducing the new Curve 30-Day Diet Plan. It's clinically proven and a brand new way to lose weight and keep it off. Without counting points forever. There are diet classes every month, which are free to everyone, no membership required. Curve's exclusive 30-day diet is designed to help you retrain and sustain your metabolism. That way you can reach your goal weight and stay there. Want to get started?
Let's try something else.
Learn a whole new way to take off the weight. Call your local Curves Club about the 30-day diet plan and find out when you can try a class near you. Free.
Tomorrow. It's been hailed as the solution to the energy crisis and the way to fight global warming. We'll explain cap and trade and tell you why the man who invented it opposes it. Plus, a woman wakes up from a dinner party 2 weeks later.
She said, you've had probably about 100 seizures in 2 weeks.
But the worst was yet to come.
They said that at the age of 30, she will die.
Tomorrow on the 700 Club.
Israel may be one of the world's smallest countries, but it's a giant in global technology. And as Chris Mitchell reports, that has implications for the United States as well.
You're looking at Israel's Silicon Valley. One of the reasons why technology here has become an economic powerhouse. A 2008 survey shows Israel ranks second behind the U.S. in six key innovation areas. One reason? Jewish brain power concentrated in this tiny nation. Israel is credited with developing the cell phone, voice technology, and even the Intel Pentium chip in your computer was most likely made here. There are also advances in solar power, medical breakthroughs, and the production of cutting-edge military technology. One prime example, the F-16I.
Over 600 modifications have been introduced by Israel into the current generation of the F-16, which is a symptom of the cutting-edge technologies and capabilities which we have in Israel.
Despite these enormous contributions, Israel remains one of the most hated nations on Earth. Why? In the new book, The Israel Test, George Gilder says Israel is hated because it's successful, free, and good. He states anti-Semitism, both throughout the ages and today, is fueled by envy and greed, be it from last century's Nazi Germany or today's radical Islam.
Well, one of the most profound thinkers on matters of this nature, George Gilder. George is here with us, and it's a pleasure to welcome you back to the 700 Club.
Great to be here again.
Thank you. Why do they hate the Jews? Why does the nation, I mean, the nations of the earth, every single one seems to hate Israel?
It's Marxism. It's envy of success and achievement. The Jews have been the greatest achievers of the 20th century, and now Jewish genius is concentrated in Israel. And so the resentment of everybody who fails his Israel test, and the Israel test is your response to the successes of others. The golden rule of capitalism, it's like the golden rule of Christianity, is that the good fortune of others is also your own. And this is what they don't understand.
Well, when the Israel, for example, was when they were in charge of the Gaza Strip, what did they do there that's not being done by the Palestinians?
Well, they opened up enterprise. And in between, the amazing thing is the biggest beneficiaries of Israel have been the Palestinians, overwhelmingly. When the Israelis inherited the West Bank and Gaza after the 1967 war, those territories became among the fastest growing countries in the face of the earth. And 250,000 Jewish settlers moved in, but almost 2 million Arab settlers moved in to take advantage of the opportunities that the Jewish settlers created. And as the population of Arabs tripled in the territories, their per capita incomes also tripled, and their life expectancies rose from 42 years to nearly 70 years. Incredible. This was a golden age for Palestine.
Why won't they wake up to the fact? I mean, I know there's a lot of propaganda, but this is illogical that they would turn their backs on something so beneficial.
It's, well, you know, all around the history of the world, people have hated Israel or hated the Jews, and they failed as a result. And countries that fail their Israel test, you've been writing about, you haven't failed your Israel test, Pat. You've been writing about this for years and years and decades. And it's whether you admire people who succeed and triumph, or whether you resent and try to tear them down.
Take the United States right now. We're on the cusp, if you will, of making decisions, and I'm not sure our country favors Israel like it used to. What is the Israel test for America, and what's the consequence?
Well, I sometimes think President Obama wants to sneak out of his Israel test and have Rahm Emanuel take it for him or something. I just don't think they really understand how central Israel is to the American economy, American defenses, American intelligence. We should prop up Israel because Israel props us up.
Well, they don't think that way in Washington. They really don't. They think, why should I sacrifice for a bunch of Jews? I mean, that's the way they think.
Well, it's evil. And it's an evil that your whole career has been devoted to combating.
That's right.
I just read a book by a a guy named David Brogue. Do you know that book called Standing for Israel? And it's really mostly about you, Pat, and your how you have fought for Israel for
over 40, 50 years. It is so important. They are the only bastion of freedom in that whole sea of tyranny and backwardness.
Yeah. Well, it's been recent that they've really embraced capitalism and freedom. I mean, this really has only happened in the 1990s. Before that, Israel was socialist. And as a result, you know, when Gaza and the West Bank, Samaria and Judea, were growing faster than any other economies in the world, they were also growing a lot faster than Israel was. Israel was in a slough of socialism during the early period. They had a lot of accomplishments. You couldn't keep them down, but they were socialist, and it's only in the last 20 years that they have emerged as a dominant force in the world economy.
Do you attribute that to
spearhead of the world economy?
Do you attribute that to the work of Bibi Netanyahu or to the
A lot is Netanyahu. Netanyahu was at the Boston Consulting Group back in the early 1970s when they were inventing what's essentially supply-side economics. Uh-huh. And so Bibi Netanyahu is the world's leading supply. He's the Ronald Reagan of our time.
What do you see as the future for them? Are the Arabs going to crush them? Are the nations of the earth going to crush them?
I think Israel is going to lead over the other nations is steadily increasing. It's never been increasing as fast as it is today. Mm-hmm. And I think their dominance is going to become increasingly evident. And that the rest of the Arab world will learn to pass their Israel test, because Israel's triumph will become so inevitable and so manifest.
Well, I believe you're right, and I hope that you're right. I hope that this is the case. The Israel Test, ladies and gentlemen, a very provocative book by George Gilder, and one that. I think I've taken it. I hope I passed it.
You did. You sure have, Pat. You're the one.
Thank you for being here. George Gilder, book again, The Israel Test. Terry?
Well, up next, abuse, anger, and depression. Welcome to the life of Stephen Cooper.
6 years into it, you kind of get used to that just being your life, you know, even if you hate it. So I just wanted out. And I struggled with suicide for all through my high school years.
Learn how that struggle helped him land his dream job after this.
We're downtown today campaigning to save America's teeth, because good dental health is about more than just brushing.
If you're one of the millions of Americans without dental insurance, call Encore Dental for affordable, quality dental coverage.
When was the last time you went to the dentist?
Probably 3 years ago?
Probably back in college.
Poor oral health can lead to serious illnesses like heart disease and stroke.
What's your excuse?
It's just too expensive.
I'm self-employed.
No dental insurance?
None.
With Encore Dental, you can receive up to 100% coverage for preventative care and up to 50% on basic and major procedures.
George retired a year ago.
You know, when I did, I lost my dental coverage.
There are no claim forms and no waiting for reimbursement. Call now for a 30-day money-back trial period.
Call 1-800-757-4903 now for a 30-day money-back trial period.
Call now and get an additional 10% off when you pay by credit card.
When Steve Cooper hit the stage, he thought he'd found his ticket to popularity. He also thought he'd discovered a way to escape the pain of his past. But as Steve looked around, another thought entered his mind. Is this all there is? Steve Cooper, some of you are in despair. Your marriage hasn't worked out. I don't know if you've had a childhood like Stephen had, an abusive father. You had to run away. Mother becomes an exotic dancer to try to make a few dollars and is hooked on drugs. What a horrible background. But what God can do is change all that. He can give hope where there is no hope. He can give joy where there is despair. He can lift you out of the trouble you're in because He's God Almighty. He is the Lord, the God of all flesh. He is the creator of heaven and earth. He is God Almighty. All the other so-called gods are just idols, but He is the one who created the earth. I'm talking about the Creator. And the Creator says to you, if you want to be set free from the thing that binds you, if you want hope, joy, and love, I'll come in and I'll give you a world of possibilities, things you didn't believe were possible. I'll give them to you. That's what God is saying to you right now. And if you want this, if you want joy, if you want to be set free, Jesus Christ said, come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. He's going to give you peace. He's going to give you joy. He's going to give you hope. He's going to fix your marriage. He's going to fix your relationship. He's going to give you a new person. Would you like that? Well, if you would, I want you to pray with me a very simple prayer and let Him do the rest. Do it right now. Bow your head. Pray with me. Pray these words. Jesus, pray with me now. Jesus, I come to you, Lord, and I acknowledge the difficulties in my life. I acknowledge the sin in my life. I acknowledge the selfishness in my life. And I acknowledge before God that I'm not what you want me to be. But Lord, right now, in the name of Jesus, I come to you. And Lord Jesus, I ask that you would come into my heart. Live your life in me, and I will live for you and will serve you from this moment on. Thank you, Jesus, that you've heard my prayer. And thank you, Jesus, that you've come in to my heart. Now, for those who prayed with me, I want to pray for you. Father, touch them now. Fill them with the Holy Spirit in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. For those who prayed with me, I have something I want to give you. It's called A New Day. It has a compact disc here, 70-some minutes of teaching. It'll tell you what it is you've done, what it means, what God's going to do for you, the joy that's there. I'll give you these if you just give me a call. 1-800-759-0700. It's absolutely free. And I want you to call and say, I prayed with Pat. I gave my heart to Jesus. And from this moment on, I belong to Him. 1-800-759-0700. Call quickly. The telephone operators are waiting, and the angels of heaven are thrilled at what you did today. Terry?
Well, still ahead, a thriller filled with drugs, lies, and deceit from a best-selling author. The one side of the story you won't find on bookshelves later on today's 700 Club.
CBN presents Superbook for a new generation. Now reimagined from the classic CBN cartoon, a new series featuring amazing Bible stories brought to life using state-of-the-art animation.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
Your kids will love being entertained while they learn biblical values like courage, loyalty, humility, and faith as they join Chris, Joy, and Gizmo in their travels through time. In the first episode, A Giant Adventure, Chris and friends land in ancient Israel, where they meet David and witness his fierce battle against the giant Goliath.
You come to me with sword and spear, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts.
Your gift of $25 or more will help create future Superbook episodes. As our thank you, you'll receive a special edition DVD of the first episode and our brand new Superbook trading cards. Give your child the advantage of learning God's Word. Superbook, superpower to change your life.
Israel, the land where God came to mankind. Imagine to be in the place where our Lord lived, to stand where He performed His miracles, to see where He taught the multitudes. The pages of the Bible come alive in the land filled with God's promises. Don't miss this experience of a lifetime. Visit Israel. You'll never be the same.
Call today.
Welcome to Washington for this CBN News Break. President Obama's new diversity czar at the Federal Trade Commission says white executives should step down to make room for minorities. Mark Lloyd has come under fire from conservatives for comments made while he served at the Liberal Center for American Progress. The Washington Times reports Lloyd said, quote, "Unless we were conscious, or we are conscious rather, of the need to have more people of color, gays, other people in those positions, we will not change the problem. But we are in a position where you have to say who is going to step down so someone else can have power." Lloyd also said the decisions will be difficult because there are, quote, "truly good people now holding these positions." America's military is struggling to find enough chaplains to minister to our troops. The Kansas Army National Guard is among the hardest hit, with 9 of its 15 chaplain posts still vacant. But leaders describe the high vacancy rate as typical of units across the country. Incentives like a sign-on bonus, tuition assistance, and extending the age limit for new enlistees have done little to reduce the shortage, and that has led to chaplains facing repeated deployments to war zones. Well, you can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at CBN.com. Pat and Terry will be back with more of the 700 Club right after this.
If you have osteoarthritis knee pain, Syndisc One treats it right at the source and helps you get back to doing the things you love. Syndisc One is the only treatment that can give you up to 6 months of pain relief with just one injection. It's a natural substance similar to healthy joint fluid that lubricates and cushions your joint and relieves pain without the serious side effects that pain pills can have. For your free information kit, call 1-800-211-9223. Syndisc One may not work for everyone. Before beginning treatment, tell your doctor if you are allergic to products from birds, such as feathers, eggs, or poultry, or if your leg is swollen or infected. The most common side effects are temporary pain, stiffness, swelling, and fluid buildup in and around the knee. Syndisc One has not been tested in children, pregnant women, or women who are nursing. To learn more, call this number, go online, or ask your doctor about Syndisc One.
77 million baby boomers hope to retire in the next 10 to 20 years, and just 3% will be financially independent. But Uncle Sam wants to help you put gold into your retirement plan by creating a self-directed precious metal IRA. There are no tax penalties or new contributions needed to convert an existing IRA or other retirement fund into gold.
This is Pat Boone to tell you about Swiss America's three-step plan for successful gold investing. First, call Swiss America. Request their free book, materials, and rare opportunity CD. Second, review the materials and learn why gold has more than doubled in the last 5 years and why experts say it may double again. And third, earn a return through growth of your gold investment.
Well, Terry Blackstock's books have been described as up all night fiction. Her line of thrillers have kept audiences on the edge for more than 25 years. And her latest, Intervention, is sure to leave readers burning the candle on both ends. Take a sneak peek.
Barbara Covington hired an interventionist named Trish Massey to convince her daughter Emily to enter drug treatment. It would be the last job Ms. Massey ever took. I'm Detective Kent Harlan, Homicide Division. It's not the first time I've seen it, and sadly it won't be the last. Beautiful young girl throws her life away on drugs and a quick fix. Still, Emily was one of the lucky ones. She had a loving mother like Barbara, one that cared enough to get her the help she needed. Barbara hired an interventionist to escort her daughter to a treatment center. Only neither of them ever made it there. The interventionist was found dead in her car, still in the parking garage of the Atlanta airport. And as for Emily, well, a security camera picked her up fleeing the scene and entering the passenger side of an unknown vehicle. It's my experience an addict will do just about anything to keep from being separated from their addiction. And in Emily's case, it seems she went as far as committing murder. Amidst this tragedy, her mother seems unwavered by the facts and is confident in her daughter's innocence. The evidence is stacked against her, yet this mother's faith is unconditional. I can't help but question that I might be wrong about this one. It's really getting to me how Barbara Covington's belief in her children and God seems so unshaken. There's nothing solid about my faith in God. Let's just say we're not on speaking terms right now. I think he's forgotten about me. But lately, something tells me I might be wrong about that too.
Intriguing. Please welcome back to the 700 Club the author of her latest book, Intervention, Terry Blackstock. Great to have you
here. Thank you for having me back.
This is a powerful book that tells the story of a daughter who's addicted to drugs. This is a story that really hits home for you. Tell us about that.
It's the most personal book I've written. It is fiction, but it's based on a journey that my family has been on for the last 6 years with our daughter, Michelle. And we found out about 6 years ago that she had a very severe drug addiction, up to 65 pain pills a day.
Wow.
And it has evolved into other drugs, and we've been in and out of rehabs, and it's just been a very difficult process. And I really wanted to write about it. I wanted to tell the story of the family, because everybody I meet now that the book's come out, everybody is telling me they have a child who's on drugs or they have a family member, and I really hope that they'll see themselves in the book and maybe even get a little guidance and some benefit of the wisdom that I've learned in this process.
You do learn a lot in a situation like that over a window of time just by the very nature of walking through it. How did you first find out your daughter had a problem?
Well, she had gotten married, and they were married a few months, and her husband called and said she has a very severe addiction. And I remember getting in my car and driving up to where they lived, about a 7-hour drive, and just not having a clue who to call, what to do when I got there. How was I going to approach this? Was I going to get her into rehab?
Did you have any idea before that, or did this just hit you out of the blue?
She had been very ill, and I thought she had a disease. I had been taking her to doctors in different states for a digestive problem, but we later learned that it was from all the drugs she was taking.
Now, you say that you believe that God actually prepared you for the fight went through to save your daughter. In what way?
Well, I had done prison ministry a few years earlier, and I got involved with the girls in the jail, and almost all of them were there for drugs. And I think God put me there so that I would have that background and a little bit of understanding.
Compassion, even.
Compassion,
yeah.
And a little bit of understanding of what to do, although choosing a rehab is something you never think you're going to have to do. And we had an intervention just like the one in the book.
What went through your mind at this time? I mean, so many times I think when a child goes through a difficulty, a parent's first reaction is to blame themselves.
Absolutely.
And say, what did I do wrong?
Oh, and I still do that. You know, there are days when I have to hand my guilt over to God and just say, Lord, just help me to move forward. But guilt is always there. And I think back over key moments when maybe I should have made different decisions. But ultimately, the choice was hers, and she went down that path. And my job as a mother has been just trying to save her life and try to get her back to where God wants her.
Let's talk about how that happened. She actually, and this is very typical of people who struggle with drug usage, she went in and out of rehab several times, even got worse than she had
Absolutely.
Been. And then a friend of yours gave you some advice.
He said, don't deprive your child of a face-to-face encounter with God by protecting her from her pain. And I realized that we, you know, sometimes God puts stones in our path, and those are the things that make us stronger. And I was really rescuing her from all the things God was trying to do with her, all the ways he was trying to make her uncomfortable so that she would change.
Gosh, that's so scary to let, to totally let go, isn't it? And to just let them learn.
Because we're taught to turn the other cheek. We're taught to forgive 70 times 7. And to reconcile that as a Christian parent with tough love is very difficult. But, you know, our culture's killing our kids, and we're not going to save them by making them more comfortable.
So, Terry, what did you learn that changed the way you were handling your relationship with her?
Well, I started studying the Bible and watching how God dealt with his prodigal children, and that made me feel much better to know that God had prodigal children, the way he dealt with Israel. And looking at Israel and the way he talked to them, for instance, in Isaiah, I thought he had to take his hand off. He had to cut them off at some point and let Babylon be the consequence. And it ultimately brought them back. And so I try sometimes, you know, to model that because it's just hard.
So how did your daughter ultimately come out of the addiction?
She went into rehab. Oh, time and time again, the last time for a year. She needed a whole year. And she is out now working and living on her own and struggling every day. It's a very hard process, but she knows where her hope can be found, where her escape is.
But after going in and out of rehab several times, was it hard for you to believe as she continued on that this time it was going to work?
Yes, but you know, as a parent, you always put it behind you and think this time it's really going to be different.
Yeah.
And I think that's the thing about a parent. We're always going to be there knowing, believing, and enabling responsible behavior instead of irresponsible.
You wanted to write about what you learned in this book that could be a blessing to other people. How did Michelle feel about your writing the book?
She's watching right now.
Hi, Michelle.
Yeah. She loved the book, and she really said, Mom, I want you to say whatever God leads you to say. And she said, I want people to know how God's worked in my life. And he is. It's so interesting. When I'm praying for her, inevitably she'll mention the time I was praying and that God was whispering something into her ear. It really does work that way. So prayer and support are very important. I started a support group of families going through this just privately and confidentially, and we've supported each other.
How important is that, to have people with you that understand the journey you're walking through?
I just don't know if I would have survived without that. And when one is up, one is down. And we've been together for 3 years. We've gotten so close. And I think everybody going through this needs to find others like them to do that with.
Is that the advice you would give to parents? I mean, you're talking about the number of young people who find themselves addicted in one way or another. Is that the advice you'd give?
Absolutely. Find some support, because and you don't have to do a big organized thing. We just got together once a week and we pray for our children corporately and pray all during the week and share and update.
Which is a good idea no matter what.
Exactly.
I just want to say Intervention is an awesome book. It's Terry Blackstock's latest, and it's available nationwide, as you might expect. And it just came out, so really this is hot off the press, and you have an opportunity to look into that. And we want to say thank you to you. And Michelle, hats off to you. Hats off to you for letting your mom share what God has taught her through this difficult journey. Terry, thank you.
Thank you,
Terry.
Great
to have you back on the 700 Club. God bless you. Pat?
Amazing revelation. Well, still ahead, we're going to bring it on with your email. Connie writes, my mother-in-law deliberately does things to hurt me and thinks she can get away with it because I'm a Christian. At what point can I say no more? We'll answer Connie's question and more later on in the 700 Club.
New from New York Times best-selling author Beverly Lewis, The Missing, a painful absence, a desperate search, an unlikely friendship.
Will Grace's search for truth lead to hope or heartache? The Missing, Book 2 in the Seasons of Grace series from Beverly Lewis, America's favorite author of Amish fiction. Get your copy today from Bethany House.
Welcome to Preview Weekend.
Welcome to Preview Weekend.
Welcome to Preview Weekend.
Regent University is amazing.
You can't understand the university unless you visited and met the people.
I felt a sense of peace walking around the campus.
And I just said to myself, that's something I have to check out.
Your calling, your purpose, your future. Find your place at Regent University Preview Weekend. Call 800-373-5504 or visit www.regent.edu/preview. Join us November 12th through 14th for Preview Weekend.
Tomorrow, it's been hailed as the solution to the energy crisis and the way to fight global warming. We'll explain cap and trade and tell you why the man who invented it opposes it. Plus, a woman wakes up from a dinner party 2 weeks later.
She said, you've had probably about 100 seizures in 2 weeks.
But the worst was yet to come.
They said that at the age of 30, she will die.
Tomorrow on the 700 Club.
Last year, Hurricane Ike slammed into the Gulf Coast and destroyed 99% of the homes in a place called Bridge City, Texas. For one elderly couple, rebuilding was impossible. So Operation Blessing gave their home a makeover from the inside out. Watch this.
Gloria Antoine is on dialysis, and her husband Gerald needs help getting around. So when Hurricane Ike flooded their home, they knew they'd have a very hard time rebuilding. Their first problem was all the mold.
We had the fans going and the door open, but you could see the mold was taking over.
Then Operation Blessing came to help. Operation Blessing's Jody Harrington told Gerald and Gloria they couldn't come back to their house for a week or two.
I promised I wouldn't go and peek, and I haven't. I said, if they just put my walls up, I'm satisfied.
But for this project, Operation Blessing partnered with the Rockford, Illinois Master's Commission. Home Depot trained more than 100 volunteers. So we're not just replacing drywall, we're completely renovating Gerald and Gloria's home.
Okay, we are really down to the wire. Come on inside and take a look. There is so much left to do. As you can see, we've got to hang these cabinets. Plumbing fixtures need to be put in. Serious work going on over here with all the painting and trim work, caulking all the loose gaps and everything. Once all that gets finished, then the carpet gets laid down, all the tile gets put in, and the furniture has to come in. And Gerald and Gloria are going to be back here in 2 days. The pressure is seriously on. These guys are absolutely amazing. They were out here till 5 o'clock this morning getting us back on schedule. The furniture is here, and it's some nice stuff.
Good morning. How you doing?
Just 6 days after they last saw their house, Gerald and Gloria were ready to come home and get to work rebuilding. So when they first saw the house and all the volunteers, they were overwhelmed.
Golly, that is a surprise. That is nice. Yeah, you are crying, huh? Be happy, baby.
It don't even look like the same house. Ooh. Oh, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, it's so beautiful.
We never expected anyone was coming to help us. I never even dreamed of anything like this. But here you are.
Oh, Lord, this is so gorgeous.
Just all
of it.
It's just beautiful, all of it to me.
We're coming home. We're coming home tonight and getting in our bed.
Everything smells so neat.
Mm-hmm. This plush carpet, I might lay on the floor. I might not even get in the bed.
Oh, y'all just don't know how much we love y'all.
Lord,
oh, Lord, forever and a day. We could never, never tell you how grateful we are. Never. But we love y'all, and we just appreciate everything that y'all have done for us.
And you guys said you had something you wanted to say to Gerald and Gloria. What did you want to say?
Welcome home!
That's what God's people can do when they get together and they work together in a project. What a marvelous thing. And Gerald and Gloria, I know, will be happy in that house for the rest of their lives. By the way, if you want to participate in Operation Blessing or the other work of CBN, we want you to join the 700 Club. Well, you can go a whole lot more than that. You can have 700 Club Gold, which is $40 a month, or the you can take it all up to Chairman's Circle, which is $10,000 a year. Whatever, because God is doing something around the world, and there's problems. There were problems, you see, with Hurricane Ike. There were problems with Katrina. There are terrible problems in the Philippines now, ghastly, ghastly problems. The water in, I think, downtown Manila, some parts were actually chest high. The people were walking around. There was that much water in the streets.
People just swept away by it.
Oh, it was horrible.
It was horrible.
Several hundred people dead. Oh, but mm-hmm. We're going to be there to help them. So for those of you who participate, I want to give you miracles beyond measure. I hope and pray that this will be a blessing to you. It'll open up the door of supernatural miracles in your life. Give us a call, 1-800-759-0700. And now it's time for those wonderful questions.
That's right. We've got great email questions today. This is from Jerry, who says, my wife and I are in our 60s. We've raised three kids who now have families of their own, and we've retired from our careers. Sometimes we feel like we've done our part in this life and wonder where to go from here. Does God still have a plan for us as we continue getting older? Does God expect us to retire? 60s, Jerry, you're a spring chicken.
Jerry, I tell you, baby, I've got 20 years on you, and it's I'm still...
He is not retired, Jerry.
They're still pushing me on. They say, you can't quit. I said, I want to settle down. No, you can't do it. Listen, live the life that God's given you. Don't be anxious, but you can't imagine what's there. And to sit around, you'll live for another 25 years. Mm-hmm. And so what are you going to do, sit on a porch and rock for 25 years? You're going to play golf for 25 years? You're going to play bridge for 25 years? How dull can it get? There's so many opportunities that you can help people. You can be a big brother, big sister. You can go out where the need is. There's so much need. And I haven't had anybody spit in my face when I've been out taking relief supplies. They're so grateful. Mm-hmm. And in this country and overseas, they're looking. I mean, there's just so much to be done.
Yeah.
And it'll make you feel so much better. You'll live longer and be healthier.
Well, and in retirement, you have the gift of time to be able to give, which others can't always do.
But that
so
whole business
great.
About sitting in a rocking chair, I mean, it's just incredibly boring.
Yeah. And deadly, I think, actually.
Deadly. It kills you. Deadly as in honest deadly.
Yes, honestly.
All right.
This is Nicole, who says, I was talking to a spirit through my friend. The spirit's name is Chelsea. She died 7 or 8 years ago when she was 10 years old. How can I help her to be at peace, and can there be good and bad ghosts?
There are no ghosts. There are no ghosts. There's such, the Bible refers to as familiar spirits. They're spirits that look like members of the family. That little child, so-called, is a demon. You're not dealing with some kid and give her a piece. Don't get into that. I mean, it'll hook you and take you down. Don't get involved. The occult, don't be involved with spirits that peep and mutter. Whew. It isn't of God. Mm-hmm. All right.
This is Vicky, who says, I'm a Christian, and I'm very opposed to couples living together outside of marriage. How should I respond to family members and friends who are living with their partners outside of marriage? Sometimes it's hard not to judge them when they know what's right but don't change. Should I still socialize with them even though it's wrong and I don't approve?
If they're Christians, you're not supposed to. You're not even supposed to eat with them if they're engaged in adultery or fornication and so forth. The other people, they need to know. A lot of people don't even know. In today's culture, who knows? There's such permissiveness. And you need to be there and say, look, here's what the Bible says. And wouldn't you guys like to get married, you know?
Yeah.
But, I mean, there may be many reasons. You know, the tax code sort of mitigates against marriage. There are other things that mitigate against marriage. And so... you need to talk to them. Say, look, well, what's the deal? Why don't you guys get married?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and see what they say.
It's a hard position to be in, you know, especially if they're immediate family members.
Well,
know?
I mean, especially if they're 40, 50, 60 years old, however. I mean, you know, it's why go through this marriage thing? They need to understand that there's some benefit to it.
Yeah. Okay, this is from Connie, who says, my mother-in-law is a liar, a gossip, and a pain to my life. Wow.
She really loves her. Yeah. A liar and a gossip and a pain in the neck.
She says, I've made a point of getting along with her for 35 years for my husband's and children's sake, but I'm tired of it. She deliberately does things to hurt me and thinks she can get away with it because I'm a Christian. At what point do I just say no more and not allow her in my life?
Today mm-hmm. is the day. And you say, listen, I've put up with this for 35 years. You have abused me, and I don't have to take it any longer. You have lied, you have cheated, and I'm not going to stand for it. And for your sake, I'm praying for you that you might come to the Lord and you might get your life right, because you obviously are not right with God. But I'm not going to stand for it any longer. I'm not going to have you. I don't want you around my house. I don't want you around my children.
You just need to say it in a truthful but loving way.
Speaking
so that
the
bitterness
truth
isn't
in love,
behind
but
it,
you've got to say it in a situation like that. I can't imagine. What a horrible thing.
Yeah, I think it would be horrible, yeah. And hats off to you for enduring it for 35
years. Yeah, but you
years,
just have to, I mean, speak the truth in love. I can't take this any longer. I am 50, 60, however old you are. And I'm not going to put up with this. You know, you have lied, you have cheated, you have done all these things, and I'm not going to stand for it. Mm-hmm. Terry, we've got maybe...
We don't have time for any more, but we want to thank you for those questions.
Right.
You can send them to us anytime.
We appreciate you all so much.
Yeah.
Those of you who are finding the Lord, you continue to call. Our telephones are available all day long, 24 hours a day, just for you. But we leave you today with these words from Psalm 146. The Lord is good to all, and his tender mercies are over all his works. That's all the time we've got. We'll be back with Skinny Wednesday tomorrow. See you then.
Tomorrow. It's been hailed as the solution to the energy crisis and the way to fight global warming. We'll explain cap and trade and tell you why the man who invented it opposes it. Plus, a woman wakes up from a dinner party 2 weeks later.
She said, you've had probably about 100 seizures in 2 weeks.
But the worst was yet to come.
They said that at the age of 30, she will die.
Tomorrow on the 700 Club.